Thank you very much for having me. And as I've learned, trying to make presentations remotely is difficult given the style of my presentation. So I've recorded the presentation and I will jump to that now. And then after the presentation, I'll return and we can, I hope, have useful conversations. So I'm so grateful to have the chance to speak with you today. I wish I could be there in person to speak with you, but I'm hopeful in June we can do that. I want to talk today about what I'll call the business model of democratic culture. And I want to make an argument that rests upon three obvious claims and one extraordinary fact. So the claims are these. Number one, democratic culture has a business model. That business model is a function of the technology of the time, and cultural understanding will be a function of that business model. Those are the claims. Here's the fact. After the 2020 election, the president, the former president, Donald Trump, asserted that the election had been stolen. And that claim led up to the extraordinary events of January 6th, where rioters stormed the Capitol to, quote, stop the steal they believed was happening when President Biden was confirmed as the 46th president of the United States. Okay, so here's the fact. I want to read from an article from the Washington Post in 2021, January 19th. Existing research shows that partisans often adopt their leaders' views. We recently fielded a study finding that indeed this was the case, although the magnitude of this effect is still startling. Over 70% of Republicans said they agreed with President Trump's contention that he received more votes than Joe Biden. Nor was this belief limited to those with lower levels of education. A majority of Republicans with college degrees in our sample said they believed that the election results were fraudulent. We asked voters whether they thought that, quote, millions of fraudulent mail and absentee ballots were cast, and whether, quote, voting machines were manipulated to add tens of thousands of votes for Joe Biden. Finally, we asked respondents' reactions to the statement, quote, thousands of votes were recorded for dead people. For each of these false statements, more than 50% of Republican respondents said it was very accurate. Over 75% of Republican voters said each one was very accurate or somewhat accurate. Only about 3% of Democrats assessed those conspiratorial statements as very accurate. Now, these views have not changed much since January 2021, as Marist found in October, asking the question, Donald Trump continues to say that the 2020 election was rigged mostly because he is right. There were real causes of fraud that changed the results. Among Republicans, 68% still believe that statement is true. Now, this fact, this belief that I've just reported through these two sources, is a function of understanding. And understanding, I want to argue, is a function of the business model, and the business model is a function of technology. Those are the claims that I'm making about culture generally, but in this talk about democratic culture in particular. Okay, I want to focus those claims by thinking about a particular dramatic moment in American history, the moment of impeachment of presidents. The first president to be impeached in America was the 17th president, Andrew Johnson. When he was impeached, media looked like this. That media created a public, and that public was fragmented and partisan, or at least so we suspect, because we can't really know, and they couldn't know, because that public's views were invisible. That's a picture here of invisible. And they were invisible because there was no such thing as polling. James Bryce, author of The American Commonwealth, described a, quote, final stage in the evolution of democracy would be reached if, quote, the will of the majority of citizens were to become ascertainable at all times. Push a button, and we could know the people's views. But at the time of Johnson's impeachment, that was not yet true. At the time of his impeachment, we were an illegible public, a public that could not be read. And so if you had said, what do the people think? That would have been a laughable question to ask because there was no way to know what the people thought about any comprehensive or complicated issue. So in the form of a matrix, we can say then that at the time that Johnson was impeached, it was impeached by a fragmented and illegible public. But that suggests we could imagine a concentrated and legible public. Okay, the 19th century evolved into the 20th century, and when it evolved, technology changed. Or specifically, I want to say two technologies changed. Number one, we saw the birth of broadcasting, a technology to enable many to hear at one time the same thing. Now, of course, what they heard was not always wonderful, but it was sometimes wonderful. FDR's fireside chat were an extraordinarily important part of the war, World War II, to bring America together. In 1939, 60% said that they got their news from the radio. By 1945, that number was 74%. Now, in this story, all broadcasts are important, but the most important broadcast is television. As Marcus Pryor describes, television changed everything, and not just because of the concentration of media. Indeed, as late as 1977, 90% of Americans said they got their news from just three networks, but also because of the addiction. People would just turn the television on and leave it on because it was irresistible within the family home. And because it was video, it was understandable. And because understandable by the wide range of Americans, it was egalitarian. It spoke to everybody. And that meant more citizens became engaged in politics, and more citizens became engaged in mainstream trusted sources of news. Each day, there was a daily lesson by the likes of people like Walter Cronkite, building a common understanding, a thick common understanding, and on the basis of that common knowledge, an increased political engagement and what we think of as the progress of the 20th century. Okay, that's change one, broadcast democracy. Change two is a coincidence that we're likely to miss. Because broadcasting takes off just at the time that polling was born. In 1936, in the presidential election, FDR stood against a man named Alf Landon. And at the time of the election, the then dominant straw poll of the age produced by the Literary Digest said Alf Landon would beat Franklin Delano Roosevelt by at least 20 points. But a young unknown graduate from the Northwestern Journalism School, George Gallup, had begun a new technique for understanding what the people believed. That technique involved a random sample of a representative body of the public. And from his technique, he predicted, to the astonishment of everyone, that Franklin Delano Roosevelt would win that important election. Now, because you don't know who Alf Landon is, most likely, you know that George Gallup was right. And indeed, when George Gallup was right, the birth of modern polling occurred. We had reached the final stage that James Bryce had spoken of, the final stage when we could push a button and with relative ease know what the American people thought at any particular moment. Now, the key here is when polling was born, it was born to a very special public. There was a happy coincidence that we learned how to read the people just when the people had something smart to say. And they had something smart to say because they knew a common set of facts. And on the basis of that knowledge, society and politics progressed. Now, both technologies are extremely important to the fate of the almost second impeached president of the United States, Richard Nixon. Because as the story of Watergate was told on television, the story of the break-in that the Nixon administration engineered of the Democratic National Headquarters, as that story was told, America listened, because it couldn't help but listen. And as it listened, it learned. And as it learned, the public was read, because we were a legible public, because polling was quite advanced. So here's a poll of the support for Richard Nixon into the period before the Watergate scandal was begun to be reported. The top line is popularity among Republicans. The bottom line is popularity among Democrats. And the middle line is popularity among independents. What's striking about these three lines is that as the story of Watergate was told, support for the president collapses in almost a perfectly parallel way across these political spectrums. And that's because we were one nation hearing one story with one obvious consequence that the president had to resign. Okay, so this almost impeachment happens in the time of a concentrated public where we all are watching the same news, and a legible public where we can all hear and understand what we believe because we can be polled. Okay, the 20th century has evolved into the 21st century. Technology has changed again. Here's a graph capturing the change in broadcast technology. This graph, first of all, maps the market penetration of the big three broadcast networks in the United States, going from about 70% in 1985 to just over 38% by 2002. Cable penetration, by contrast, is rising dramatically, rising from just over 40% to over 80% by 2002. And more significantly, the average number of channels on these cable technologies goes from about 15 to over 100 by 2002. Now, what these three graphs together say is that technology was making a much wider range of broadcasts available to the public so that the people could be watching whatever they wanted. They didn't just have to watch what the three broadcast stations were playing. And cable, of course, was only the beginning. We saw the birth of the internet layered on top of those wires. That internet then exploded the number of media platforms that were broadcasting and making content to the public available, so that there were many, many sources, and we could say the public was fragmented again. And this fragmentation had a dramatic effect on what people watch, because those who were forced before to watch the news, because the news was on at the same time on all three channels, they were not now forced to watch the news. They could watch whatever they want, and they didn't, in the main, watch the news. The vast majority shied away from news programs. And those who do watch the news, we call them news junkies, they are also partisan junkies. They are the most extreme on the left and the right, who focus their attention almost exclusively on the news. And that shift changes the business model of broadcasters. No longer is a broadcaster like Walter Cronkite successful with this type of polarized audience. Instead, broadcasters like Sean Hannity, or even worse, Tucker Carlson, are popular. Because partisan pays, and more partisan pays more. Here is perhaps the most frightening graph in American politics today. This maps the ideological content of the three cable networks in about 2001. And what this shows is that the ideological content of MSNBC, the liberal network, supposedly, Fox News, the conservative network, supposedly, and CNN were essentially the same. But in that period until today, we've seen a radical divergence as these networks identify their ideological base and begin to play directly to that base. Now, the internet, of course, only makes this worse. Tristan Harris was a Google engineer who left to start the Center for Humane Technology. He has been talking about the science of attention that Silicon Valley focuses its work upon. It's a science designed to engineer our attention, to overcome our natural resistance to watching digital platforms ad nauseum. It's a kind of brain hacking, exploiting evolution, the evolutionary fact that we can't resist random rewards, or the evolutionary fact that we can't resist endless wells of content, exploiting evolution with the aim to sell ads. That's the business model, to sell ads. And that business model creates an incentive. The incentive is to know more about us, not just by watching us, but by poking us, tweaking us, asking us questions, rendering us vulnerable, reaching down the brain stack to leverage our insecurity so we reveal more so that they can sell ads better. This is the business model of Instagram and Facebook. As the Facebook files revealed by Francis Haugen demonstrate, Facebook knows that it is exploiting our psychology, our insecurities, our emotions and passions to drive engagement on that platform, regardless of its effect, especially its effect on weak and vulnerable populations. As Zeynep Tufekci puts it, the companies are in the business of monetizing attention, and not necessarily in ways that are conducive to health or success of social movements or the public sphere. Now, this is a point we can't miss. If the business model is engagement, unfortunately, we are most engaged if we engage in a politics of hate. We are polarized and ignorant if we are going to make those platforms most profitable, and thus to sell ads, those platforms drive us to be polarized and ignorant. And as they do that, democracy is weakened, as we saw in the United States in the extraordinary riots around January 6th, and in the expression of that in ways that most of us found incomprehensible. Now, there's something astonishing about this reality. A business model is driving this. If you told me that we were going to destroy democracy to address climate change, I would be against it, but I would understand the trade-off. If you told me we were going to destroy democracy so that we could end world hunger, again, I'd be against it, but I would understand the trade-off. But the idea that we've allowed a business model to evolve that weakens democracy so, just so that some can get richer, is something I just can't understand. And when we understand together the effect of cable and the internet, what we understand is that this means we have a more fragmented public today than we did before, and we have a more partisan public today than we did before. So you might ask, is that a return to where we were in the 19th century? And the answer to that is no. Because they in the 19th century were not legible. You could not poll them. You didn't know what they believe. We are. We are a legible public. And because we're legible, we become a normative public. We are a not-to-be-ignored public, or publics, because what we believe, as the politicians understand it, is what the politicians need to listen to. As Barack Obama puts it, if you watch Fox News, you're in one reality, and if you read the New York Times, you're in a different reality. And so as politicians learn to say, my people say this, so what am I supposed to do against what my people believe? Now, these technologies are important, critically important, to the fate of the third president impeached by our Congress. This was actually the second, but the third and fourth president, Donald Trump. Because think of what these different realities do. These different realities mean people live with different stories, and those different stories have a different effect on them. We don't see a poll like this measuring popularity for Donald Trump as people learned about the charges against Donald Trump in either the first or the second trial against him. Instead, the popularity graphs for Donald Trump look like this. There is no change because each public is being told the story it wants to hear and it stays focused and committed to the view it had before. Even after January 6th, we see just a tiny blip in change in support for Donald Trump. Okay, so the point is, Donald Trump is impeached where the public is fragmented, yet still legible. Okay, so when you've got an illegible public that is fragmented because of the media, it's the elite that drove impeachment. And where the public was concentrated and legible, it was the public's views that drove impeachment. It was a people-driven impeachment because the people had a common view that Congress was respecting. But where you have a fragmented and legible public, I fear you will see a crazies-driven process of democracy. And in thinking about these crazies, we should distinguish between those who knew that what was being said about the 2020 election were false, and those who didn't know, people like Senator Josh Hawley, who certainly knew that what was being said about that election was false, versus the people who, those sad sals who marched on the Capitol in the name of stopping the steal, they didn't know. They believed they knew because they had been led to believe those facts. Why? Well, we know why. We know in the period between the election and January 6th, the dominant network for conservatives 800 times spread the idea that the election of Joe Biden was not legitimate. And those facts plugged into the Facebook algorithm for spreading hate and emotion spread the understanding that too many Americans still have to this day that that election was stolen. Now, the point is, this is because of the business models driven by advertising that make this so. In an advertising-driven platform, profit will not be a function of truth. Profit will be a function of engagement. And the real question we need to ask then is, how do we do democracy here? How do we engage in a project of coming to common understandings about common problems so that we can choose common solutions when we don't even understand the worlds we live in as the same? Okay, one final thought before I stop. This is one of my favorite movies, The Favorite, by Yorgos Lanthimos. I want to play a short clip from that movie right now.
Dearest Queen, you are mad, giving me a palace. It is a monstrous extravagance, Mrs. Morley. We are at war.
We won!
Oh, it is not over. We must continue.
Oh! Oh, I did not know that.
The Queen is an extraordinary person.
They were all staring, weren't they? I can tell even if I can't see, and I heard the word fat. Fat. And ugly.
No one but me would dare, and I did not.
She's been stalked by tragedy.
Everyone leaves me. Dies.
Now, this film betrays a certain style. The style is to render the monarchy absurd, embarrassing, but hidden. Until it is not. Because what we know about the history of monarchy around the world is when it is not, monarchy is destroyed. Now, I want to say the same is true with democracy. If the demos, the public, us, becomes absurd or seems absurd, ignorant or irrational or self-destructive, if that happens, then democracy is destroyed. If the business model of information is to render them, the public, absurd, then democracy will be destroyed. Now, it's an uncomfortable truth that we are actually getting very close to this now. We are losing faith in us in America. This poll by Pew asks what the public's confidence in the public's political wisdom is. So that's asking us about our confidence in us. In 1997, almost two-thirds of Americans had confidence in the public's political wisdom. But in the period since 1997, we've seen those numbers reverse. So now almost two-thirds of the public has no faith in the public's political wisdom. In a world where the public does not trust the public, how long can democracy survive? And in a world where the business model of media drives us not to trust ourselves, how long can democracy survive? That's my question. I look forward to the conversation to see if we have some sort of answer. Thank you very much.